Amen. Thank you, Addison, for a beautiful rendition of Christ Alone. I want to welcome everyone to University Caroline, a community sent to help anyone and everyone become a follower of Jesus. I want to thank Hal Klopfer, who will be serving as our online virtual greeter today. And I want to thank you for joining us this morning for our live gathering here. You can find resources and ways to participate in our gathering by visiting ucumc.net/live. And I want to encourage you to, as we stand and sing in a moment songs of praise, I invite you to do that. Just stand. Stand in your living room. I want to go ahead and give a shout out to MJ and Bob. I hope you finished your walk this morning in time to worship with us. Encourage you to stand and sing with us at appropriate times. And Bob, send a picture, if you would, confirming you were standing. All right. So before I highlight a few things that are happening in the life of our church, I want you to check out this video from Kids Ministry.
Whoa.
What is that? What?
It's my craft. It's a hawk that I made for my craft station for VBS.
What is all this stuff? What are we doing?
Well, we're packing our bags for our virtual VBS. Everybody's going to get bags for each individual station. They're going to be marked, and they're going to be put in your box, your own box.
Very important question. Will I get one of these?
Yeah.
Let me see. Whoa! I'm keeping this one, though.
Are you a conductor?
Some might say that I am a conductor.
Oh, man. Okay.
So here's what else you might be able to expect from VBS. Virtual this year. Games. That stuff will be in your box. Bible. Missions. Crazy videos. You'll probably see a lot of us.
Will the crazy videos be in the box?
The crazy videos won't be in the box, but they'll be in this fancy box called a computer.
Oh, all right.
Amazing. So we want you to know, this is really important to us, that this virtual VBS is not just a sit and stare at the screen for hours type of activity. It's very hands-on. We want you to know every activity, every video we have has something for you to do. This is an activity a week for you, not for us. We want it to be for you. We want you to have so much fun. So there will also be music. You're going to see all kinds of different things, but every single thing is interactive for you. We're so excited.
So excited. It is going to be so easy. No stress for the parents. It's going to be lots and lots of fun.
And you can even make this.
Yeah.
We'll see you.
Wow, I can't wait to get one of those hats, Jesse. Looks like fun. And be sure to sign up online and claim your virtual box now. Go ahead and do that. Next Sunday, May the 31st, from 1 to 3, we want to wish Pastor Bobby and the Holbrooks family a farewell for their new adventure to Tallahassee. It's going to be a drive-by style. So we want to encourage you to drive by, no stopping. Well, there can be a brief stop. We call the California roll, kind of roll through. Share a moment with Bobby and his family. They'll be under the Epic Porch. Decorate your car, create a fun poster, and have fun doing it. Also, thank you for your gifts, your continued gifts and donations to the community pantry. We are still collecting stuff for them, and our office is open here from Monday through Friday, 9 to 3. If you have any prayer requests or concerns or want something, you would like one of the pastors to pray for you immediately after the service, I encourage you to call 407-494-6204. Leave a message or send a text, and we'll speak to you a little later. And then our relaunch team is in the process of reviewing and improving ways to open our facility safely. So we want to thank those who have filled out the relaunch survey. And if you haven't done that, please do so today or tomorrow. This online survey is real important to our work. And so we'd like you to make sure you've done that by tomorrow. And then finally, we're thankful for your online presence this morning. And before we transition into our worship through song, we want to recognize the graduating class of 2020 for their hard work throughout this year, their faithfulness in completing their schoolwork very strong, in this really kind of weird season of education. So join me in celebrating the graduates, the class of 2020.
Good morning. I would like you all to stand where you are and let us praise God together with our opening hymn, All Praise to Thee.
All praise to Thee, for You, O King Divine, Your glory freely did resign, that in our darkened hearts Your grace might shine. Humbly stooped to death on Calvary. Alleluia, alleluia. Let every tongue confess with one accord in Jesus Christ is Lord, and God the Father be by all adored. Alleluia, alleluia. Jesus, Thine all-victorious love shed in my heart abroad, then shall my feet no longer rove, rooted and fixed in God. Oh, that in me the sacred fire might now begin to glow, burn up the dross of base desire, and make the mountains flow. Refining fire go through my heart, illuminate my soul. Scatter Thy life through every part, and sanctify the whole.
And all God's people said, and amen. And will you please remain standing as we join together in our responsive reading this morning. It comes from Psalm 4. You can be sure of this. The Lord set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will answer when I call to him. Don't sin by letting anger control you. Think about it overnight and remain silent. Offer sacrifices in the right spirit and trust the Lord.
Amen. You may be seated at home. Well, we come to the part in our service where we acknowledge the offering that many of you have already given this week and online, or some of you who may be writing your checks out now or logging in online. We want to give thanks to your faithfulness in giving week after week. And today we acknowledge Memorial Day weekend, and we are so grateful for another day off on Monday just to be with family. Again, social distancing and all that good stuff. But on this weekend, we are so grateful for the folks, men and women who have given their life for the freedoms that we enjoy today. And so as you gather around and maybe do a little cookout or whatever you do as your Memorial Day transition, give thanks to the men and women who've given themselves on their ultimate sacrifice of their life, as well as acknowledging that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so we are so thankful for the gift of Jesus, his death and his resurrection. Today is another important day in the life of the church, of those who have a Wesleyan tradition. This is Aldersgate Day. Aldersgate Day is the day in which John Wesley unwillingly went to a gathering on Aldersgate Street, or Straight Street. And it is in that experience that he felt his heart strangely warm, and that he trusts in Christ, in Christ alone. And so we acknowledge this important day in the life of Wesleyan Christians all over the world. The Methodist movement would turn the world upside down, and we are a part of that and grateful for that. Let us pray. God, we are so grateful for this day. We are a grateful nation as we acknowledge the sacrifice of friends and relatives throughout the generations who've given themselves that we might enjoy freedoms that we have. And so we're so grateful for this time. And we thank you for John Wesley as well. We thank you that he did go attend that Bible study, and that your Holy Spirit moved in his heart and set a world on fire. And so we're so thankful for that. God, may that same Spirit move in us this day. May we be a people that looks at your word and has the word impact. Earth as it is in heaven, and give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Addison, and thank you, Rich. I appreciate that. On Friday, President Trump declared that churches are essential. Of course, we already know that. But he also said that churches should reopen. Now, the interesting thing, of course, is that it's hard to reopen something that's never closed. I'm thrilled that the reality of this church is that we've been active and engaged and doing all kinds of ministry and mission. And I prefer the word relaunch. And so I hope that you will continue to pray for our relaunch team, because these are difficult decisions. Some of you won't like the decisions, and some of you will love them. There's no way to get it just right sometimes, but our goal is to get it just right. But so please pray for them as they kind of walk us through all that way. And one of the things that you're going to experience today is this morning when I came in, I'd been working on a message for 1 Timothy chapter 4 all week long, and I just felt like I shouldn't preach that message. And so I said, God, what is it that I'm supposed to preach on today? And I said, well, given that people are in many cases are physically, emotionally, and spiritually exhausted, maybe even depressed, I prayed and was led to do a message on from 1 Kings chapter 19 with Elijah, who has this incredible spiritual victory, and then he experiences incredible defeat, and he runs away. And the reality for us is lots of famous people experience spiritual exhaustion, even depression. One man, many years ago, his friends removed all the sharp objects. He was in such a bad mood. They were just worried about him. And he wondered if he would ever be able to recover and feel better again. That's our 16th president, Abraham Lincoln. Winston Churchill, he used to call some of his dark moods the black dog. The black dog had come to visit him. And in a season like we're in right now, sometimes it feels like the black dog has come to visit us and we are exhausted. There's a figure in the Old Testament, King David. We think of him as a spiritual giant, and he was that. He was a man after God's own heart. But he also was somebody who experienced a depth of pain and black dog depression. And we're going to look at that in a moment. That's in Psalm 31. We'll get to that before we get into 1 Kings 19. So let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for this church. I thank you for the relaunch team and for the people who are giving their time and their talents and their energies to help us figure this out. And we're not going to get it perfect, but help us to try and get it just right. We're grateful for your presence in all the decisions that we make. And I pray now that you would come and help each person hear exactly what you need them to hear, regardless of the words that come out of my mouth, and help me get out of the way so that you can come and truly be the way, the truth, and the life in the lives of those who are gathered here today and in our homes. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So this is King David's experience in the 31st Psalm, beginning at verse 9. He says, "Have mercy on me, Lord, for I am in distress. Tears blur my eyes. My body and soul are withering away. I am dying from grief. My years are shortened by sadness. Sin has drained my strength. I am wasting away from within. I am scorned by all my enemies and despised by my neighbors. Even my friends are afraid to come near me." That sounds like social distancing, doesn't it? "When they see me on the street, they run the other way." Have you had that experience where people they want to make sure they stay even more than 6 feet away from you if you come across somebody walking? "I am ignored as if I were dead, as if I were a broken pot. I have heard the many rumors about me, and I am surrounded by terror. My enemies conspire against me, plotting to take my life. But I am trusting you, O Lord, saying, you are my God." You see where he gets to? He lays out openly and honestly just how painful and how difficult things are. But then he comes back to, he says, "But I am trusting you, O Lord, saying, you are my God. My future is in your hands. Rescue me from those who hunt me down relentlessly. Let your favor shine on your servant. In your unfailing love, rescue me." I love that the man after God's own heart, David, can cry out to God openly, honestly, with exactly what's going on within him, and also acknowledge, "I am going to trust in God." And I think that's good for this season that we're in. It's good for any season that we're in to remember that God allows us the privilege of bringing exactly what's on our heart and mind to him, to his throne of grace, offering it up to him. And then he kind of metabolizes it and gives it back to us in a helpful and hopeful way, trusting in the living God. So here's Elijah. Elijah is this incredible biblical figure. About 150 years after King David, he comes onto the scene. He's a great prophet, and one of the things that he does in chapter 18 of 1 Kings is he has this spiritual battle with the Baal worshipers, with the prophets of Baal. And there's 450 of them gathered together, and they're talking about how God's going to rain down fire, and it's this big challenge. And Elijah defeats all these 450 prophets of Baal. And it's just him. And it's a remarkable, miraculous defeat of these other prophets. And God is there in this moment, in this incredible victory, this wonderful miracle. And then in the next chapter, it's completely different. It's a reminder that oftentimes what happens in the midst of some great spiritual victory, we always have to remember that spiritual defeat is nipping at its heels. And so that's what happens to him. In this moment, we turn to after this great and incredible victory in 1 Kings 19, verse 1. It says, when Ahab got home, he told Jezebel everything Elijah had done, including the way he had killed all the prophets of Baal. So Jezebel sent this message to Elijah. May the gods strike me and even kill me if by this time tomorrow I have not killed you just as you killed them. Verse 3, Elijah was afraid and fled for his life. He went to Beersheba, a town in Judah, and he left his servant there. Then he went on alone into the wilderness, traveling all day. He sat down under a solitary broom tree, and he prayed that he might die. I have had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life, for I am no better than my ancestors who have already died. So here's Elijah. Just like David in Psalm 31, he lays out the dilemma that he's experiencing. He lays out his depression in the midst of this incredible, great victory. Here he comes to this moment of spiritual exhaustion. And now what he did there, too, is you notice he's all alone. He intentionally went to be all alone. But he's not shy about owning exactly where he's at in this moment. Now, this incredible man of God suffers in this moment. This is a good moment for us to remember lots of great people, lots of incredible people who've walked with God suffer with spiritual exhaustion and even depression, and it's tough. It's difficult. But in this moment, Elijah chose to be all alone. Verse 5. And, of course, you feel it. Take my life. He's ready to give up. Verse 5. Then he lay down and slept under the broom tree. But as he was sleeping, an angel touched him and told him, get up and eat. He looked around, and there beside his head was some bread baked on a hot stones and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again. Now, I love this because in this moment, God's provision shows up for Elijah. God knew what he needed. And one of the things that he needed rest because he was exhausted physically and spiritually and emotionally. And he also needed sustenance. He needed food. But of course, this is also a metaphor for the spiritual nourishment that we need. But God literally took care of his physical needs in this moment. And it was a gift from God. It's absolutely vital for us to have. I think it's important for us to recognize, you know what? When we're spiritually exhausted, when we're really down, it's important that we, what? Eat well. It's important that we sleep well. Those are gifts from God that are so important to helping us through these difficult times, to be genuinely refreshed. Verse 7, then the angel of the Lord came again and touched him and said, get up and eat some more, or the journey ahead will be too much for you. So the angel shows up and says, okay, I'm going to need you to go on a journey. I'm going to need you to take a trip. So I need you to be fully sustained and ready for what's coming. The reality is that God always has us on a journey. We're always moving forward. And it's like in this moment, as the angel comes, it's abundantly clear that God wants to spend some time with Elijah. God wants to encounter him and help him through this time. So we too are always called to go on a journey of discovery and grace and connection with God. And that's important for us. He wants to walk with you every single day. He wants to pour his encouragement into you consistently and regularly. But we need to be on a journey to help make that happen. Verse 8, so he got up and ate and drank, and the food gave him enough strength to travel 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Sinai, the mountain of God. There he came to a cave where he spent the night. Well, there's nothing subtle about that, is there? 40 days and 40 nights. I mean, that's how long the 40 years in the wilderness for the Israelites. Going to Mount Sinai, that's the mountain where Moses received the Ten Commandments from God. And so he's making this journey. He's going to the mountain to connect with the living God. It's an important journey. And in this moment, I think it's important that he comes to this deep place, the cave, and he spends the night there. And then it says, but the Lord said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? Now, on first glance, that's a really odd question, isn't it? Well, what am I doing here? Well, you told me to come here. I'm following your directions. What was it that you wanted me to do? But the Lord is inviting Elijah to again lift up his complaint, to cry out to him. He wants to hear it from Elijah's own words. And Elijah replied, I have zealously served the Lord God Almighty, but the people of Israel have broken their covenant with you, torn down your altars, and killed every one of your prophets. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. Now see, Elijah gives voice to the anger and pain that is within him, the all aloneness that he is facing. And it says, go out and stand before me on the mountain, the Lord told him. And Elijah stood there. The Lord passed by, and a mighty windstorm hit the mountain. It was such a terrible blast that the rocks were torn loose, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, there was the sound of a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. So, see, Elijah has experienced God in remarkable ways. He's seen God do incredible miracles through his ministry. And God was alive and active in big and powerful ways. But here, God's not in the storm. God's not in the earthquake. God's not in the wind. God's not in the fire. God's in the gentle whisper. And that's an important thing. Sometimes God speaks in a still small voice for us to listen, not the big, powerful whirlwind and the victories that he's experienced. And sometimes in a moment of physical, emotional, and spiritual exhaustion, it's important for us to live in the presence of God as he whispers quietly. It can be in something really small, in just sitting outside and enjoying the beauty of creation and worshiping the God who has provided what is there. It can be the simple, small way of receiving a kindness from a stranger or the kindness from a friend. It doesn't have to be a big thing, but we listen carefully for the still, small voice of the living God. And then it says, and a voice said, what are you doing here, Elijah? I love it. It's like God once again is saying, Elijah, get it all out. Here's the grace that God gives of you have permission to bring exactly where you are, exactly what's going on in your life to my throne of grace. I want to hear it all. He replied again, I have zealously served the Lord God Almighty, but the people of Israel have broken their covenant with you, torn down your altars, and killed every one of their prophets. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. Did you notice those are the exact same words that he just laid out just a few verses earlier? He lays it out again. And it's as if Elijah has a tape that's playing within him, right? How many of us have tapes? Old tapes that we play about our emotions, and we say the same things over and over again, and we have to, there's a constant recovery process from that. Verse 15, then the Lord told him, go back the same way you came and travel to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive there, anoint Hazael to be king of Aram, then anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, to be the king of Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from the town of Abel-Meholah, to replace you as my prophet. Anyone who escapes from Hazael will be killed by Jehu, and those who escape Jehu will be killed by Elisha. Now, what is God doing here in his grace? God has listened to him. He's listened to his complaint. And now he says, I'm giving you a purpose. I want you to go anoint as king Jehu, and I want you to mentor him. I want you to anoint as the prophet to replace you, Elisha, and I want you to mentor him. I want you to pour back into the next generation. You have a purpose, Elijah, and don't ever forget it. I need you to pour in to people that are coming behind you for my glory. It is good to be given a clear purpose by God. And you and I, we have a clear purpose from God. We are called to be a community sent, to be to help people be followers of Jesus. That's anyone and everyone. And that's our mission. And that's so important for us as a body of Christ to always remember that we have a purpose. What's your purpose? What's your God-given purpose? How does, when you listen to the still small voice of God, how is God speaking his purpose into your one and only life? But I assure you that it's beautiful. So in this moment of spiritual exhaustion and depression, the reward that Elijah gets is a new job. Go out and serve me. Make my purposes known in this next generation. And then the next verse, verse 18 says, "Yet I will preserve 7,000 others in Israel who have never bowed down to Baal or kissed him." Now, how many times in this narrative has Elijah said, "I am the only one, God. I am it. I'm the only one who's serving you. I'm the only one who's being faithful to you." God says, no, Elijah, you've got it wrong. There's 7,000 others who've never bent the knee to Baal. And of course, it was interesting that to worship other gods, they weren't saying, "I don't love the God of Israel." They were hedging their bets. More gods are better than one. I know that God has said that I'm supposed to have no other gods before me. I'm supposed to serve him alone. But wow, wouldn't it be better to have many other gods? I like this one, but I want all the other ones too. When we were in Israel recently, it was like striking that we were in a village, Israeli village, an ancient village, and there was an altar to make sacrifices to other gods right there in the village. And it was a reminder that was incredibly common to worship many other gods. But here, God, in his grace, reminds Elijah, you've never been alone. There's 7,000 others just like you who are serving me faithfully, loving me, and wanting to do the very best to worship and serve me. You are not alone. And God's saying to Elijah, not only are you not alone because I'm with you, you're not alone because there's many other people with you. And guess what? In this season, in this period of spiritual exhaustion that we're maybe struggling with, it's good for us to remember we're not alone. We're here for one another. We care about one another. The God who loved and cares about you also sends you people into your life to care about you as well. So remember, there's 7,000 just like you who love God, called according to his purpose. There's many more than those 7,000 in this world. So God made sure that Elijah was well aware of the fact that he had a purpose and that he was well aware of the fact that you have many other people who are with you in this moment. Here's the thing. When we're depressed or spiritually exhausted, we oftentimes send ourselves the wrong messages. And we need our minds to speak the truth of God's word into our hearts. And the reality is, God's given us the grace of one another to speak into one another those words of life and hope and health. And so it's important in the midst of this. Now, I love here also that, like, so what God did, God sent him on a journey, right? Which is interesting because he would have had it was about a 100-mile walk. So he made sure he was well-nourished, well-fed, that he'd had enough liquid to drink, and he sent him on a long 100-mile journey, which, of course, is good. It's good for us to get out and physically move around. Why? Because our body needs those endorphins. They're little chemicals that our body gives to us to help us feel better. So when you're feeling depressed or spiritually exhausted, it's good for us to remember that exercise is one of those good gifts from God too. I think, and this is just kind of an aside, do remember that if you're in a season of depression for too long, it's okay to take some medication. That's not in God's word. I'm just letting you know, I think that's okay. Some people say, well, that's just a crutch to lean on. Well, if you break your leg, you use a crutch. Now, if you've been recovered from your broken leg for 6 months and you're still using a crutch, that's a problem. But in a season of needing a crutch, it's okay to use a crutch. And so it's good. We might need that in a particular season. So let's review what happened for Elijah and what he needed here. In the midst of his spiritual exhaustion and his depression, God fed him, gave him real food, real drink, which led also to spiritual nourishment, right? That's so important. He was needing to be refreshed. He sent him on a journey of not only self-discovery, but of discovery of God's voice in his life. And God spoke to him. God let him speak. God listened to what he had to say. And then he let him get it all out. And then God said, you have a purpose. You're going to mentor the next generation. I want you to live this out for my glory. And then he said, God said, by the way, you're not alone. Don't ever think you're alone. I'm with you, and there are so many other people on this journey with you that care about you, that love you, and want the best for you. And so remember all those things in the midst of this difficult season where maybe, just maybe, you're feeling spiritually exhausted or you know somebody who is. And so I want to encourage you also. I want you to encourage, when you see somebody like Elijah in that moment of spiritual exhaustion, come alongside and be one of their 7,000. Be the person who pours into them in the midst of all that they're facing and offer that care in this season. We love God and we thank God that we are called according to his purposes and that we get to be his church in this place at this time. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for your amazing love and grace. We thank you for who you are and for your unique call in our lives. We love you today. I pray for everyone out there who is spiritually exhausted, who thinks they're alone. Remind them that not only are you with them, but you've surrounded them with lots of people to care and love them. And God, help us be open and available to hearing your still small voice in all kinds of different ways. We are your grateful people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me save that thou art. Thou my best thought by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom and thou my true word. I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord. Thou and thou only first in my heart. Great God of heaven, my treasure thou art. Great God of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Thank you, Pastor Jamie, for listening to God and having that audible to make the call to shift the message that you'd prepared for. Because I know there are folks who are watching out there who are physically and spiritually exhausted over it. But remember that God is with us and with you on the journey. So be still. Be still. Listen to God's gentle whisper. And let us know. Let us know if we here at University of Caroline can be of any assistance physically for you and your family. Go now in the peace of Christ. In the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, go and be the church. Amen and amen. Thanks for joining us this morning for worship.